Around before the service, but it is time now to do what is appropriate and right as we begin, and that is to bow our heads in prayer. I'd like to ask the Lord's not only blessing over this, but just His truth to become evident, Father God. Your truth to become evident in our lives today. The reality of You as King. The reality of You as Creator, the reality of You as our Savior, and the Lord of our lives, all of those things, let that reality just penetrate us today as we celebrate together as a church, bound together by the power of Your Holy Spirit. We love You and we appreciate You, and the only reason that this is possible, the only reason why we come together is to worship You, Jesus. To hear Your word, to learn, to grow, to become. Thank You. Thank You, dear Jesus. Thank You. It's in Your mighty name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen indeed. The opening word today is from Romans. And of course, everything today from the word has to do with congregation. It has to do with how we live together as congregation, how we worship together as congregation, and some of the challenges that we face as congregation. And when I say as congregation, I don't say the congregation, because we are not the only congregation. I hope that this word spreads throughout the church. I hope that this word is being preached in the local church all over the world. Because we are called to be in relationship with Christ and with one another. Romans 15 is where I'll be reading from first. May God, who gives this patience and encouragement, help you live in complete harmony with each other, as is fitting for followers of Christ Jesus. Now, I'm not going to do this the entire service, but this is one of the themes that we're going to understand today, is that the things that Scripture speaks of, the human behaviors of which Scripture speaks, are impossible for us to fulfill without the power of the Holy Spirit. Have you ever been nice to anyone 24/7? Get your hand down.
No.
You're not Jesus. And even Jesus, we could point out times when He was less than nice, when He was had righteous anger and righteous indignation. And so we're going to talk a lot about all of these wonderful sounding themes about being together, loving one another, tolerating each other's faults, all of which are absolutely impossible without the power of the Holy Spirit. And even then, we've got our speed bumps, right? Okay, so let me read this, let absorb this for what it is. Then all of you can join together with one voice, giving praise and glory to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, accept each other just as Christ has accepted you, so that God will be given glory. Remember that Christ came as a servant to the Jews to show that God is true to the promises He made to their ancestors. He also came so that the Gentiles might give glory to God for His mercies to them. That is what the psalmist meant when he wrote, "For this I will praise you among the Gentiles. I will sing praises to your name." And in another place it is written, "Rejoice with His people, you Gentiles." And yet again, "Praise the Lord, all you Gentiles. Praise Him, all you people of the earth." And in another place, Isaiah said, "The heir to David's throne will come, and he will rule over the Gentiles. They will place their hope on Him." I love that. I pray that God, the source of hope, will fill you completely with joy and peace because you trust in Him. Then you will overflow with confident hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. Key phrase, right? Through the power of the Holy Spirit. Without the power of the Holy Spirit, we are another community organization trying to do good in the world. We are a good community organization trying to do good in the world, and the best thing that we can do for the world is help save souls. There's the difference. So we speak the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Would you join me, please, in this glorious chorus and this wonderful hymn as we move forward today? I will serve you for Christ. Father God, we just pray you receive that as our prayer right now. As we shed away the things of this world and open our eyes and open our ears and open our hearts to learn and to grow and to receive and to become by the power of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Please, be seated. I think what I want to do is actually move these things for now. About, and I think that the church needs to hear it. I think we need to hear it. I think that in many cases it is the elephant in the room. Is that sound okay? Because I hear a big echo. Can you turn me down a little bit? And it's just been something that I kind of stumbled over a couple of weeks ago when I started talking about how it is summertime and how sometimes people find it very difficult to come to church and those sorts of things. Because speaking about congregation and speaking about how we are all drawn together and speaking about what it looks like to be a church and to be the church is all well and good, but it's not complete if we don't talk about how we defend ourselves from attacks of the enemy. There's something that I need to just speak about because I've got 6.5 years now here at Churchtown. And there have been dozens, if not 100 people who have come by and have professed faith in Jesus Christ. Some whom I've baptized, some who we have become members, and where are they now? And this is not in any way, shape, or form any speaking against any people, any condemnation. I'm not questioning anybody's faith or anybody's intentionality. I'm saying that there is a force at work against what we are about to do today, that all of you prospective members, all of you prospective leaders need to be completely aware of and go into with your eyes open. Because it is not coincidence that when a person submits to the lordship of Jesus Christ, that all of a sudden, all hell breaks loose in their lives.
Yes.
It's not a coincidence. Each individual isolated case, you can say, well, this was my case. But I see the 10,000-foot view. And it's not coincidence. It's not coincidence. And I've seen people who have given their hearts and given their lives to Jesus Christ first and then into membership or leadership in our church. And then, boom, right? Satan starts scratching the record. And we're wondering, what's going on? And I need to take a step back. I can't go there. I can't do this. I can't. I'm just convicted. I've fallen. I have backslid. I did something horrible. Whatever the case may be, I've seen it all. I've heard it all. And in many cases, like I said, I was just very blunt and I put that out there today. Because when we talk about these things, it is the elephant in the room, isn't it? Because it's like, well, I'm questioning Ginger's commitment. I'm questioning her faith. I'm questioning her loyalty. No, I'm not. I'm saying that, and I've always said this, it's kind of a backhanded compliment to you. It's kind of a backhanded compliment to the church. Because Satan has no interest in a dead church. And Satan has no interest in a dead person. A spiritually dead person. He's got that one in the back. And I don't know what membership means around the globe. I don't know what it means in the other local churches of God. But I know what it means to me. And it's this. I'm stepping out in faith. I'm making another public profession that I am planting some spiritual roots, and I will not be uprooted easily, and I will not bend and sway with every blow of the wind. And I know, and this is the piece I'm preaching today. I'm going to preach it through Ephesians. Eventually, I actually will get the scripture, because this is where it all comes from. I promise you. It's not the world according to Brian. This is the piece that I'm preaching today, and I know what I'm signing up for. I would be remiss if it was just all about the celebration, and we should celebrate. We should embrace each other today. We should celebrate today. We should just proclaim that victory today. The growth and the spiritual growth. That's my standard answer. Because what does every other pastor ask, right? Is your church growing? And you know what my answer is. I think so, but you have to ask them. Because that's what matters.
Yes.
Because that's what matters. But that's not what membership means to a lot of different churches. It's what it means to me, though. Okay? So let's take a look at Ephesians, knowing that that's what we're going to talk about. Knowing that we're going to talk about all of the highs and all of the lows and all of the challenges that we're going to face together as a church, as a people, moving forward. Knowing that Satan will come against you and is coming against us right now. And knowing that we are engaged in this spiritual battle from a position of victory. We are victorious on the hill right now, and he's coming up at us with his troops. We've already won the ground. Okay? So I'm not one of these name it, claim it, that I got to walk in victory. I preach, I profess, I live from a position of victory. It is ground that I can lose.
Yes.
If I say, okay, Satan, Jesus, I don't want this anymore. I'm all in, Satan. Let's go. I can do that. All right? So I'm preaching, I'm living, I'm professing, I'm proclaiming from a position of victory. Okay. So all of that in context. Ephesians, again, here I am back in Ephesians. I hope you've read it by now. As Paul, by the power of the Holy Spirit, teaches these congregations, there isn't any other blueprint I'm ever going to use than that, in how Paul taught congregations. There's nothing new here. Therefore, I, a prisoner for serving the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of your calling, for you have been called by God. He's not talking about the priesthood or pastors, or he's talking about the believer. Mm-hmm. You. And this is another thing sort of in America that we do. You've got your vocational ministers. That's my job. And then you've got whatever the case may be. You know what I'm saying? No, we are all called. When you submit yourself to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, you are called into the ministry. Wherever you are, every conversation we've done, we've had this sermon a thousand times, haven't we? Every conversation that you have, every place that you are. So you have been called. You're not a participant, my brothers and sisters. You are a participant. You are not an audience. You are a congregation. This is not a dog and pony show for your benefit or for my benefit. This is how we strengthen one another. This is how, hopefully, after your experience today, we are all just a little bit more equipped to go out there, because we know what's coming. And we say, no, I've got my brothers and sisters at Churchtown. I know that he believes in me. I know that they believe in me. And there isn't anything that I can't do or overcome or walk through. I know it. That's what Chanley's all about.
Right on.
Oh, okay. I got one verse under my belt. But this is so much on my heart. Because, again, we talk about teaching the fullness of Scripture. in a large portion of Paul's teaching, a large portion of Jesus' teaching, is about how to navigate these waters. We are soldiers dropped behind enemy lines when you become saved. When we walk out of these safe confines, which I feel like I can talk to any of you about anything, when we walk out of there, we must be equipped to deal with the slings and the arrows of Satan, and also do what Jesus asks, be witnesses to the gospel, the good news of salvation through Jesus Christ. If we're not doing that, if people are just attending church because it's fun, or because it's a good show, or because they love the music, or it's a trendy thing to do, whatever, you can, and you're probably not going to have any attacks from Satan. So enjoy yourself. Okay. I hope you enjoy yourself, so don't get me wrong either. Yeah. Always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other, making allowances for each other's faults because of your love. God is love. Make every effort to keep yourselves united in the Spirit, binding yourselves together with peace. For there is one body and one Spirit, just as you have been called to one glorious hope for the future. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father who is over all and in all and living through all. And brothers and sisters, that's what separates the church from every other organization on earth. That paragraph right there. You're not going to find in some secular organization's mission statement, regardless of how much good they do, and I'm not saying that secular organizations do good. For crying out loud, even our government sometimes by chance does good. It just happens. Like, people can do good. It's okay. We know what good is and we do it. But this is what makes the church the church. One God, one Spirit, one love. It's very Jamaican. One love. It just came out there. One God and Father who is over all and in all and living through all. There's the difference. However, he has given each one of us a special gift through the generosity of Christ. That is why the scriptures say, when he ascended to the heights, he led a crowd of captives and gave gifts to his people. Notice that it says he ascended. This clearly means that Christ also descended to our lowly world. And the same one who descended is the one who ascended higher than all the heavens, so that he might fill the entire universe with himself. Now these are the gifts that Christ gave to the church, the apostles, the prophets, evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers. Their responsibility is to equip God's people to do his work and build up the church, the body of Christ. Now we know we talk about other spiritual gifts and so forth. And it's not the spiritual gifting that I'm going to focus on. It is to equip God's people to do what? The work of the church by the power of the Holy Spirit of God. So we're all going to be, you submit your life to Christ, you profess your belief in him, and you submit to him as Lord. You receive spiritual gifts. Some apostles and teachers and pastors and that sort of thing. But everybody is equipped. And together, through leadership and teaching and understanding, we learn how it all works together for the better benefit of God's kingdom. If we're not employed in that way, then we're not living fullness of our calling. And I can even say, I'm really, really glad for your church attendance and all of those different things. But none of that matters to me if you're not living your full calling. When I preached to those kids at Carlisle Christian Academy, my only message was, I want you to love waking up in the morning and being who you are. And who you are is not defined by all of that garbage. Who you are is defined by your Savior.
Hallelujah.
And I want you to love waking up in the morning. Don't, and I use my example, don't take 25 years to get there.
Find it, yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. Don't take a whole lifetime to get there. Explore that now. You'll never regret it. So your gifting, your calling, all made possible by the Holy Spirit of God. To individually, to be who you are called to be, who Jesus sees that you are supposed to be, and collectively, as the church town church of God, the local church, who are we to be? Are we submitted as a body to his vision or our vision? And then the kingdom of God, where are we? How do we plug in, to use the modern vernacular? Mm-hmm. Right? How do we make this world a better place? By the power of God's Holy Spirit. This will continue, okay, building up the body of Christ, this will continue until we all come to such unity in our faith and knowledge of God's Son that we will be mature in the Lord, measuring up to the full and complete standard of Christ. We understand that as our calling. Say, whoa, but that is our calling. What's the point in trying to become if you don't have a point B? What are you becoming? Well, you're becoming Christ-like, right? Through your own edification, your own strengthening, you're becoming more and more the essence of Christ. That's the goal. So if I say, oh, just become. Become what? You're becoming Christ-like. Now that's very open-ended because he's going to be Christ-like in you, and in your context, in your life, that's going to look completely different than over here and what it looks like in you, see? But we're becoming Christ-like. We've already talked about some of those things. The way that we tolerate one another's faults. The way we live in a state of forgiveness. The way that we love one another and demonstrate that. So we see that this is all the Holy Spirit is woven in and through and among each one of us right now as he flows through us and into the person beside you, and he binds us in one vision. For this church, for your life individually, and for this church, and for the church universal.
Amen.
And how history will be completed through him. Then we will no longer be immature like children. This is what I want to talk about last. We won't be tossed and blown about by every kind of new teaching. We will not be influenced when people try to trick us with lies so clever that they sound like the truth. Instead, we will speak the truth in love, hopefully like you felt I did to you this morning, right off the bat. That was my goal. You speak the truth to you in love, growing in every way more and more like Christ, who is the head of his body, the church. He makes the whole body fit together perfectly. As each part does its own special work, it helps the other parts grow so that the whole body is healthy and growing and full of love. That is a great vision. That is a great vision. That is an absolute impossible vision in our own strength. We're not every organization that has ever tried to do that has failed and blown apart. The church has been the church now for 2,000 years. Mm-hmm. By the power of the Holy Spirit of God. So those things are possible. Point one, don't be blown about. All of you, and praise God, I just had conversations with three other people, and so we've got a total of 15 individuals coming up for membership today. But you need to, like, if I don't want to scare you off. I want you all in, but I can't lie to you. If you are all in, then he's coming after you. He's going to come after your weaknesses and try to get wedges in there. He's coming after your relationship to try to make you feel this way or that about the people that are closest to you. He's coming after your strengths to try to blow them up into gluttony or do whatever he can do with your strengths and make you feel more self-important than you are. He doesn't want you invested in the Holy Church of God. He doesn't want you invested in doing the work of the kingdom, the work of the church that we just talked about. He doesn't. Satan doesn't. You folks that are going to help make decisions, Mary and Stacy and Roger, who I'm just looking so forward to, their counsel and understanding and being a part of the decision-making process, you need to understand that the leadership team at church down here has been a revolving door. It's been a revolving door. Why? Coincidence, sheer coincidence, that that small group of people gets attacked the way they do. No, it's not coincidence. And I don't know if I'm patting our church on the back or not, but this is alive and a spirit-filled church, and Satan hates that.
Right.
Try to cut the head off it at every chance he can. You need to know. You need to know. But together, from our position of victory, we need to understand. Together, him first, and then our closest relationship second, and then together, from our position of victory as saved people, Satan can't touch us. He can't do anything but make us feel certain ways and get us to do stuff. He can't do anything but get us to think certain things and then get us to do stuff. I quit. I hate you. I'm not coming. Those are our decisions. That wasn't Satan.
Right.
He manipulated. He thoughts, feelings, but he got us to do that. And they said, I'm leaving this church council. I'm leaving this church. I'm walking away from my profession of faith. This is all just a bunch of junk. That's your decision.
That's right.
You need to understand that you're going to be confronted with that decision. If I teach you, if I say anything else to you any other way, I'm lying. And I'm sugarcoating it. But that's going to be the decision you're going to have to make. Well, I just had a huge mess up. I don't even deserve to be here. Shut up. Yes, you do. This is exactly when you need to be here most. And yeah, I'm the pastor that will tell you, shut up, get in church. This is when you need to be here most. Because you have messed up. Because I mess up every week, and I belong here.
Absolutely.
Talking to you in the Word of God, praying with you, worshiping with you.
Yes, Jesus.
Have you lost without me? So we are. There you go. Now that if there's anyone left that still would like to become a member or invest in leadership of the church, it's a glorious thing, kicking the devil's rear end. It's an amazing thing. It's fantastic when we're all bound together. It's a great feeling. But yeah, I know you tried. Get away. Shut up.
Get behind me.
Right?
Yes,
it's that's an awesome feeling. So let's do it. Let's do it together. It should be enthusiastic. It should be visionary, positive. But it ain't easy. That's what you need to know. It's the real deal. There's a battle for your soul. God loves you and wants to save you and be with you forever in eternity. Satan hates God and wants to make you grieve.
That's right.
He doesn't love you. He doesn't want to give you stuff. He doesn't want to make your life easier. He doesn't want you because he cares anything about you. He wants you and he wants this church because he hates God and wants to make him grieve. That's what the scriptures teach us. It's nothing to do about you. It's everything to do with his hatred of God. So he will lie to you and get you to do whatever he can. And God will grieve that decision, Brian. Oh, come back, Brian. Okay? But you've got us, and you're not going anywhere. There's nobody here that's going to say these words today, and then I'm not going to see them again. But, Pastor, this happened. I know that happened, and I know this happened. Get to church. So we can talk about it, we can pray over it, we can help you, we can walk with you, we can support you, you can be okay.
Yes, Lord.
Don't let Satan isolate you and destroy you.
Amen.
Okay, enough said. I've said it 1,000 times. this is fantastic. Woo, this is fantastic. Would Bill and Susan Gable, Klein and Mary Stradley, Joan Beck, Connie Strader, Andy and Rusty Snyder, Ronald and Helen Wilson, Alexander and Andrea Allen, Tim Smith and Paul and Pat Weitzel, would you please join me in the front? I got to move things, like I said, Yeah, just come on up here, any old place. Any old place. You all have your papers, so that's fine. We'll fit a lot of people up so we can come on up, and you can turn around and face me. Because you got to read these things here. And again, that it makes me self-conscious, because you're reading them to him, not to that idol or that image. But you're spiritually, you're reading them to Jesus Christ, not to me. So I'll stand to the side. And really what this is, I talk about membership. I'm not going to preach about it, so you guys don't worry. But membership used to be all about what it looked like on paper. And even when I came to Churchtown, the membership service, so to speak, the application had a lot of legalistic language in it and those sorts of things. These are the requirements. These are the things that would be expected of you. This is the, we would expect you to give this, that, and the other thing of your gifts. And membership in this local body is a profession of commitment to the local body. And it is a profession of support for the local body. But membership is not about me and you. It's about you and him. Understanding the things that I just talked about and saying yes. Like I said, to open the service. This is where I want to be. I want to plant spiritual roots. I want to see this local body grow. I'm excited for what it looks like in the greater body of Christ. And now, after this sermon today, I know what I'm getting into, and I'm not going to back out. The first time that the wind blows, my roots are not going to come out, and I'm going to go flying like a tumbleweed. I've seen that too many times over 6.5 years, and I'm going to fight it. I've been too nice, and I haven't fought it. And I'm going to fight it. Okay. You have your papers. You see that the language is really mirrors a lot of the language that we read in Ephesians. It's about commitment to Christ and about commitment to the body. The first one is relative to the church universal. Would you please read with me, as I read very quietly, this covenant to the church universal? We, whose names will be recorded as members of the Church of God, do mutually and solemnly covenant and agree for the promotion of our welfare, the salvation of others, and the glory of God, to unite in church fellowship, to live in Christian peace and love, and to walk and live according to the commandments and ordinances of the Lord, as He has revealed the same to us in His holy scriptures, which contain, as we believe, the only authoritative rule of Christian faith and practice. Okay? That basically says if you ever stop believing in the Bible, we will have a problem in terms of our relationship. You don't bring to me any other sorts of ideas. I believe in the Holy Word of God. I believe in His church around the world. In unison again, would you please recite, as I lead, your covenant with the Churchtown Church of God? Having personally experienced the new
God, and being in agreement with them, and desiring to be associated with those of like precious faith in Christian fellowship, I hereby apply for church membership. It is my desire to be in fellowship with this congregation and to invest in my family at Churchtown with all of the gifts with which I have been blessed. We've talked about that in Ephesians as well. So I want to make sure Bill and Susan, Klein and Mary, Joan and Connie, Andy and Rusty, Ronald, Helen, Alex, Andrea, Tim, Paul, and Pat. Have you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, having been reborn by the Word and the Spirit? Will you follow and serve Him as Lord of your life? If so, answer, I have and I will. Do you accept the Bible as the inspired Word of God to make it your guide through life? And do you promise to follow its precepts faithfully? If so, answer, I do and I will.
I do and I will.
Do you promise to support your Churchtown family faithfully by your presence, your natural gifts and talents, as well as your spiritual giftings, as the Lord has seen fit to bless you? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
At this time, I would like to lay hands on these individuals, and I would like all members of their family and of their family to come on up. Come on up. Let's gather together. If you want to come on up here, like I said, if you want to lay hands with Susan and Bill or Andy's over here, come on up through and fill in. We can make enough room. Into your heart, if you believe them to be
and you desire to live in holy congregation with your brothers and sisters here in Churchtown, with this as your model, that is what Paul just taught us, with this as your model, please affirm this belief by saying, I do and I will.
I do and I will.
And as we pray, deeply, thank you, Lord. We remember our baptisms at times like this, and that is what the oil is for, the oil of the Old Testament, the oil of the New Testament, the baptism by water, and the baptism by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen? And so we are all anointed by His Holy Spirit. This oil has no power. Only God has the power. But it does serve as a reminder to all of us who we were and who we are now. Who this church was and who this church is now. And that's what I like about it. It's simple and it's pure. And just because I am who I am, did I miss him? I love you. Father God, as we stand before you today and we're about to call Roger and Stacy and Mary to come into the center of this, it is your anointing that we seek. We profess our faith through the water and through the oil. We profess our faith through the prayer, but it is your anointing, Holy Spirit, that we seek. And we submit to that anointing now. Thank you from the bottom of my heart, all 15 of you, for the commitment that you're making today. It personally means a great deal, as you can imagine. And so now I would like to call Mary and Roger and Stacy, please come forward. I have a couple of words for you. As we prayed over this, this has been a struggle. I've been very honest with you in terms of the incredible leadership that comes from the pews. This church is loaded with leadership. And this church does the work of the church by that power, but it does need a center point. It does need a backbone. But I've been so scared because every church I've seen fall apart has fallen apart because of church boards. Church boards have hurt more people. Church boards have hurt more pastors. Church boards have divided more people in the body of Christ. But this thing, so I've prayed and I've prayed and I've prayed. I've spoken very honestly with all of these people. And I'm going to continue to seek more leaders to be intentional like this. But we need to know what we're up against, don't we? If this is the way it's going to be. He's going to try to set me against you and you against me. He's going to try to set you against them and them against you. He's going to use that language that I'm using right now. Well, it's us, it's them, it's blah, blah, blah. No, it's us.
Right.
These are your roles, these are their roles, and these are your roles. And everybody has that role. And we've got to stay faithful in that commitment. So I'm super happy. Mary, Roger, Stacy, you've been called by God and affirmed by the people for leadership in the Churchtown Church of God. This ministry is a blessing. And a serious responsibility. It recognizes your special gifts and calls you to work among us and for us. In love, we thank you for accepting your obligation and challenge you to offer your best to the Lord, to this people, and to our ministry in the world. Live a life of Christ. Live a life in Christ. And make him known in your witness and your work. Today we will recognize and install Roger Lance as elder and spiritual leader, Mary Stradley as elder and spiritual leader, Stacy Hughes as deacon and spiritual leader. Roger, Mary, and Stacy, do you this day acknowledge yourself a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
I do that too. Will you devote yourself to the service of God in the world?
I will.
I'm sorry. If so, answer, I will.
I will.
Will you live and lead so that you enable this church to be a people of love and peace? If so, answer, I will. Will you do all in your power to be responsible to the task for which you have been chosen? If so, answer, I will.
I will.
Let's take a moment and pray. Almighty God, pour out your blessings upon these, your servants, who have been given particular ministries in your church. Grant Stacy and Roger and Mary grace to give themselves wholeheartedly in your service and your service alone. Keep before them the example of our Lord, who did not think first of himself, but gave himself for us all. Let them share his ministry and consecration, that they may enter also into his joy. Father God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, guide them in their responsibilities. Reward their faithfulness with the knowledge that through them your purposes are accomplished through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Stacy, thank you. Thank you for your blessings. Roger. We anoint us by the power of the Holy Spirit to bind us together as one. All eyes up and on Christ. All ears open to hear his word, and all hearts open to receive it. Thank you all from the bottom of my heart. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Everybody, would you thank our joining in celebrating this morning? Take a break, get some air.
Yeah.
Woo! All right.